We have an hour. We have a lot of people here. I'm going to have to be, or we are going to have to be ruthlessly efficient. You can be efficient and I'll be ruthless, but we do have to be very careful about timekeeping. Everybody in this room understands the importance of the greening of our building infrastructure. What we have here are representatives and panelists who actually know what to do. The World Green Building Council, who actually pulls it all together, the commission which helps divide the policies for how that is put together. Global Worth is a real estate developer that delivers the buildings, and PKO, the mortgage bank in Poland, brings together the financing for that. What I hope we'll get out of this session is an understanding of how all these bits can be brought together. Before we do that, I'm just going to ask Terry McCallion, who's the Director of Energy Efficiency and Climate Change at the EBRD, to give a presentation which is exactly 7 minutes long.
And my joke is that my joke's actually 7 minutes long, so if anyone wants to hear my joke, we're going to have to do it after the event in the margins. Forget about following up with detailed technical questions. You're all very welcome. So we're from the EBRD. Energy efficiency very much in the DNA of the bank. We've had an energy efficiency financing team since 1994. Not many banks can say that. We do a lot more financing these days than we did then. It was a bit of a cottage industry and a bit of an experiment, but we've really scaled it up and mainstreamed it into the way that we work. So I'm going to, given that I don't have terribly much time, I'm probably going to be fairly superficial, and I'm going to take a quick run through what I want to say. So, I mean, as is sort of, you know, required in these things, I'm going to start off with the glossy bit. You know, the glossy bit is that we do a lot of financing in buildings, in energy efficiency in buildings and for sustainable buildings. It's not easy. We'll come back to that. We won't focus too much on the challenges because I think most people know what those challenges are. But we, when we work with our clients, we try and mainstream and have tried to mainstream the green financing into the way that we work. So when it comes to buildings, we work directly with clients to influence how they invest, how the proceeds of EBRD financing is used. We work directly with infrastructure companies for buildings like airports and port terminals. We work with retail chains. We work with the public sector. And we work with public-private partnerships, really to make the buildings as sustainable and to integrate energy efficiency, resource efficiency, and climate resilience as much as possible into the scope and the design of buildings up front and the way that they're being refurbished. There's also this intermediation challenge because many of the projects are very small. So we work through funds, equity funds. We work through commercial banks. And that's the way that we bundle some of these smaller projects together by either bringing in standards that the investors and their sub-borrowers have to adhere to, or very, very often by providing a specific package of technical assistance and capacity building and skills to help banks basically develop products for on-lending for, let's call it green financing, including energy efficiency in buildings, in the SME sector, the residential sector, and with housing associations. So how do we do that? We've got operational people in the team who aren't just bankers, but they understand buildings, they understand technologies, they understand the constraints, they understand how to do capital investment appraisal so that we can convince our clients that these are good investments. So we can provide audits, we've got tools that do energy efficiency assessments, that do climate resilience assessments. We've got a product called a technology selector, a tool that basically screens technologies that push the boundaries in markets so that we can start to drive the market penetration of specific technologies. The one I always come back to is condensing boilers. The market penetration of condensing boilers in a country like Georgia is close to zero. So something that has to be addressed in the short term before we move to near zero energy buildings by 2050. All of this has to be supported with, you know, facts, data, robust processes, and a robust, what we call, monitoring and reporting and verification protocol. Now, that works, right? So we've financed over the last 10 years, say, about 70,000 assets. That's about 28 million square metres of property that has been greened over that time. Now, that's the glossy bit. So the murky bit is it's not enough, right? And why is it not enough? Because 97, if we just look at the EU 28, 97% of the buildings still have to be refurbished in order to help meet that near zero energy objective by 2050. The policy is there, the support mechanisms are there, but we have to head in that direction, but there's a lot to be done. If we look at embodied energy, not just what buildings use and consume in terms of energy, if we look at embodied energy in the products, it's about 50% of energy that's embodied in the way that we build, design, and operate buildings, and about a third of the waste that we produce is from the construction and the building sector. Big problem. It's a very fragmented market, so it's hard to get to it on scale. So we're missing opportunities. We're locking in buildings that are being designed and built and constructed right now. So that's the negative part, the glossy part and the negative part. Now, what I think is, we will get there. You know, the Commission and, you know, what's happening today and this discussion on the ambitions of the different EU member countries on climate change, I think, is there. I think the only question is how and what's the pace at which we get there. And, you know, my opinion is that it's a complex thing with lots of fragmentation in the market and lots of different interest groups. And we have to be able to align the interests of all of the stakeholders. And that's, I think, why we've got a nice balance on the panel today. We've got people who look at things through different lenses, but somehow we got to get everybody together. We've got to herd all the cats and we've got to get everyone pointed in the right direction and doing the right thing and remove these misaligned incentives. I think we have to establish networks to do that. And I think for me, it's very important that a little bit like what we've done with commercial banks, I think we have to create one-stop shops that are about access to finance, but they're also about information and that they're operating to the right standard for today, the right standard for the medium term, and the right standard moving towards the right standard for the 2050 objectives. And I think that's really, really important. There've been a lot of panels on this topic, right? And yesterday people were saying the finance isn't an issue, but finance is actually always an issue. But finance isn't the issue, it's what the money is used for. And we have to combine that with the access to financing. We have to combine those standards and the availability of information on products, materials, equipment, and the life cycle benefits of all of that. We have to raise, I think, awareness of the benefits. So people still need to be told about climate change and the catastrophic impact. I know they're getting a little bit immune to that, but it has to be an important part of the messaging. People need to take responsibility. They need to step up. But we also need to focus on the value of sustainability investments in buildings, because the EU 28, roughly, we have to invest about 10 trillion euros until 2050, but that's likely to add, just in terms of value to the buildings, twice that. So it's a financial attractive thing. We've got to create well-functioning supply chains to increase market penetration of the existing technologies, and we've got to deploy the new technologies on things like demand generation response and automation and control. And we've got to streamline the process. And so it's a lot to ask. We've got to streamline the process. We've got to have the right policy context. It has to be clear. And we have to have a robust monitoring standards quality assurance framework. So we will get there. And that's the challenge of the panel. Actually, they're going to tell us what it is we all need to do to create these one-stop shops and how we align these interests and how we're going to get there. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Just to show how the EBRD is approaching this question, we're going to show you a very short 2-minute video about our hospital in Zenica.
Posao ljekara, a i drugih zdravstvenih radnika u velikim bolnicama je težak i zahtjevan. Zgrade bolnice u Zenici su izgrađene prije 60 godina. nikada do sada nisu značajno rekonstruirani. Imamo problem plavljenja ovih prostorija u situaciji kada je veliki priliv tečnosti kod jakih kiša.
Zenica je, vjerujte, lijep grad, kao što vidite, samo da nije zagađeno pretežno. Dobro, malo ljeti ima zagađenja, ali zim je baš ta čuda.
Ovaj grad ima lijepu infrastrukturu, imamo predobre zelene površine. Također vola da neko da dođe do vlasti, da se očisti zelene površine na smetoma, zatim da se smanji zagađenje u gradu. Jer šteta je puno omladine, grad je sve zagađeniji.
Teško je postići uslove za dobar rad zdravstvenih radnika i liječenje pacijenata, posebno zbog teške organizacije i hlađenja, i grijanja, i ventilacije. Novi projekat rekonstrukcije bolnice predviđa da će se svi ovi segmenti izgraditi.
To je fino, dobro, znaš. Da povijem se ti ništa to toliko strašno.
Sorry about that. Let me now introduce our panel. James Drinkwater is the director of the European Regional Network at the World Green Building Council. To my left is Paolo Re García, team leader for buildings and financing in the Energy Efficiency Unit and in the DG for Energy Renewables Research and Innovation Energy and Efficiency. To my left is Dimitri Pegamalis, head of construction and development at Global Wealth, and to my right, director and head of treasury at PKO Bank, the mortgage bank, Agnieszka. Possibly. We've been practicing that, but I didn't get it quite right. James Drinkwater, Terry McCallion said there's lots of different elements here herding cats. It's your job to herd cats, isn't it? So how are you doing that? How do you bring people together? And I understand you want to show something as well.
That's great. I love that phrase. Actually, it rings very true to my ears, and I think this point about, you know, we've been creating some scale in this market, but we've still got a long way to go, and we've got to kind of re-look at the problem. It is really critical right now. And so in the Green Building Councils now, for a number of years, we've been looking at this phenomenal opportunity we've got in the national renovation strategies that each country in the EU has to develop, to actually say, well, what does a strategy to renovate a nation look like? And precisely how do you put people together to do this? And when we started to look at this challenge at the very beginning, we just had governments and some of construction industry and a few NGOs together. And we started to say, well, hang on a minute. If we've got all the right people at the table, why isn't it happening at scale? So there's clearly people missing. And over a campaign through our Build Upon programme, funded by Horizon, of about 100 events across the region, we've started to tap into these pockets of who do you have to marshal and kind of bring on board? What are the new communities you need to tap into and the new value chains that we need to build to actually get this done? And one of the sort of startling findings that we found in most countries, there were about sort of 100 or so major initiatives, from those tackling awareness raising to those building capacity and skills of professionals in the public sector, to those providing finance, to those working on the policy and the kind of how to administrate a market. But that ecosystem of solution providers often weren't talking to one another. And I often say, you know, in an organisation, you don't have 100 staff who don't communicate to one another. And I think that for us, what we've been looking at in this challenge of setting out national renovation strategies is, firstly, how do you marshal and align all that existing resource that's there? For those NGOs bravely raising citizens' awareness of why would you tackle climate change in your home or your office, we need to connect them with the mortgage banks offering the means to do this, because they're worried that the demand in the market's not there. We need to actually start to articulate across those providing different types of solutions to scale an important market. We need to be able to articulate strategies across these. So both at the national level, we're trying to build those new coalitions and value chains between the energy efficiency geeks in our community, the banks, the valuation community, and those people out in communities raising demand. That's critical.
How do you... Knowledge sharing, how do you facilitate that?
So we've been running a programme called Build Upon. It's a campaign that's run the last couple of years to actually, both at a national level and in the major cities, major conurbations where lots of this renovation has to get done, we've been trying to actually bring these groups together to ensure there's the outreach to bring new groups in, and that actually, for example, the energy efficiency and the banking sector are sat down together when they're designing, you know, new policy instruments like building renovation passports, and they're doing it in a way that's technically sound for our sector, the construction sector, but it also actually makes sense in terms of the way that, building performance data is being conveyed to financial institutions. So we've been really committing to, and over time, measuring the quality of collaboration, trying to ensure that that community is getting larger, and that we're also getting outside the capitals in this national policy debate to the city level to build those similar ecosystems, to bring those solution providers to the local level to renovation programmes.
And what are the obstacles to actually achieving your aims? What stands in the way of that?
Do you know what? I think the biggest thing is culture. People from different worlds actually spending long enough in the same room to start to speak a bit of a new language. And actually, when we started a few years ago a programme to scale the energy efficiency mortgages market. And actually, it did momentarily feel like we were all speaking very different languages between the banks, the valuers, the energy efficiency people, and so on. And actually, it's just structurally committing to saying, well, where are the bits of shared value? Where can we be actually developing instruments and new products
together? And you're a global organisation, but is there a not invented here syndrome for where things do come from somewhere else and have to be accepted? Is there an acceptance challenge in that way?
Do you know, I think we often, in the European community, we talk a lot about sharing best practice, replicating and scaling so people can leapfrog. Do you know what? I think the biggest barrier we've found is actually really pinpointing best practice. Where has an awareness raising, a skills, a finance or a policy initiative really been able to track it's had the sort of impact it's looking to generate over time? Can we robustly say we're not just transferring a good idea that may or may not work in a different context, but can we actually more meaningfully track that progress? And that's kind of one of the challenges I think our new Energy Performance Directive, Energy Performance of Buildings Directive, sets out to more meaningfully track progress of these initiatives.
And presumably there is a huge cost for all of this. And how is that being financed? We are financiers. You've got a bank next to me. But is there enough money around? And how do you galvanise that money to make a difference?
You're going to have to ask the finance experts. But I know obviously we're working with EBRD and EBRD's regions to actually look at how can you overcome some of the technical issues, those policy dialogue issues, to then bring financing into projects. I think what we're seeing is a lot of the banks are starting to look at how do you Paris-proof your portfolio. Actually, they've got all these assets that aren't aligned with the Paris Agreement. That's going to be an issue at a moment in time. The money's there. I think one of the big challenges now is demand creation, actually. So we're really trying to work at the city level, particularly, to look at how we engage citizens, how we build some of that demand, then how we streamline what our sector, the construction sector, delivers, and how that segues with new financial instruments like energy-efficient mortgages.
And I understand you have a video as well, which does have... subtitles or not?
There are some subtitles.
Okay.
We're all going to have to...
I shall move out the way again.
It's going to be a bit of a game of musical chairs.
Dimitris Pergamalis, I'm going to stay here for a while because I can see the way this is going. But you are responsible. I mean, you deliver these. You're a real estate developer, so you're confronted with the problems of finance, of getting the regulations in place. So what are the challenges for you? You know what you want to do. What stops you doing it?
First of all, I would like to thank you for the invitation. It's a great honor for me being here. To the subject now, regarding the challenges that there are in during construction and development of commercial buildings, I would say that some of the challenges could be the lack of know-how or the lack of technical capacity of the uncertainty of the durability of the solutions or the lack of design or the lack of integration. But I won't stay long on these. I would say that the biggest problem is that we need to change our mentality. It's a matter of culture, as already said. The main problem that we have is that we live in an area. We live in a period that people are changing. Technology is changing as we are changing, and the design briefs of the buildings need to be updated. And sometimes, okay, we need to see that we are designing buildings the way we designed it in the 80s or in the 90s, which is not correct. People are changing. So the first thing we need to do before entering into the renewable ways of creating energy is to reduce the energy that we consume. We cannot live without energy. I mean, the first thing I was told when taking some lessons on the green buildings that the best system in the building is the system that is off. Okay, let's turn off the lights, turn off the air conditioning, but then this area would not be fit for purpose. So we consume, and we will certainly we will continue to consume energy. So how we reduce this energy, how we obtain solutions that we reduce this energy so that we can make renewable solutions more viable. And this is the main challenge that we have with the contractors and with the designers. I'll give you an example. In the recent years, there was lots of discussions about continuity of business and redundancy in the business and all these things due to the huge servers that there were in all the huge IT companies that practically they are the majority of our tenants. So this required a huge amount of energy and, of course, consumption. So we were designing the buildings in a way to ensure redundancy and to ensure high capacity of energy. But this is now moving. We are all moving on the cloud. We do not need high servers in the buildings. We do not need all these things. We do not think powerful air conditioning. We do not think redundancy in case of power interruption. So we need to rethink the way we dimension the buildings in order to obtain, to reduce over-design of the buildings. And by reducing over-design, we create sections of budget that can be allocated in an other forms of improving the building or even introducing renewable energy solutions within the building. Photovoltaic panels, geothermal solutions, cogeneration, etc.
So are you saying the biggest problem you face is really a technological one, a science one, or rather than the financing to do it?
We need to go back to engineering.
Yeah, yeah.
We need to go back to the basis. I mean, many people look at construction from strictly from an economical point of view by putting some figures in a spreadsheet. This is not the case anymore. We need to go back to engineering and re-engineer the buildings and redesign them the way that we work.
One more thing.
There are three trends, basic that I have identified in the future or modern office buildings that is, first of all, the green, the requirement for energy efficient buildings, the smart building, the introduction of new technology, okay, and the co-working. If we take part of all these trends and introduce them in our briefs of design and educate our designers, we as landlords or as developers, then we can have better buildings and more energy efficient buildings.
Thank you very much indeed. Let's just see your video very quickly, and then I'll sit down again.
Have you ever wondered what makes an office space a perfect fit for your company to develop your objective? It's that special mix that helps businesses grow through productivity, collaboration, creativity, fostering innovation, and genuine care and well-being for its employees.
Yes, we know it's a complicated puzzle to piece together, but we're here to help you retain and recruit the best talent.
By providing an office space with exceptional tools, enabling them to do the best work of their careers and feel good in their surroundings.
We're not just an ordinary developer. We're experts at building office spaces for the challenging age of tech disruption. No matter where you want to set up a business in the city, we've got you covered.
Paolo Regazzia from the Commission. How do you get the right policies in place to facilitate what all these people want to do, and how are you pushing that forward?
Well, first, good afternoon to everybody, and many thanks for inviting us to this session. Just a question for clarification, because I understand that I don't have a video, but I should combine somehow my slides with the replies to your questions. So,
No.
But should I then go to the slides directly and combine them?
Yeah, that's fine. If you'd like to, yes, please.
So that somehow I combine the reply to your questions with my presentation in the interest of time. So in terms of the... No, it's not working. Well, I get started on the question then. So, voila. So in terms of the right policies, I think those of you who were present in the previous days in the various sessions heard a lot about what we have put in place in terms of new regulatory framework. And there, I think we have some elements that are really quite powerful in helping us in the challenges that we have, in particular for the building sector. And one of them is the revised energy performance of buildings directive, and there in particular the reinforced long-term renovation strategies. And why that is quite important is for two reasons mainly. First, because we have for the first time within that directive, but also in general within the energy efficiency legislation, such an obligation with a 2050 goal in it already embedded in the legislation. And that's quite important and should be quite a push for action at national level. And also because it has a finance component within it. And that was one of the lessons that we learned from previous policies, that definitely for tackling the challenges that we have for buildings, we need to act also very closely on the finance side and have also an enabling framework, but have also some hooks, some provisions directly on finance within the legislation. And then the other piece of legislation that I think is quite important is, in fact, the governance framework. And I think we heard quite a lot this week about the first draft plans that have been put forward by member states, whether maybe the ambition is to be improved, much more needs to be done. And in fact, what is very helpful there is to have this tool to help us address these maybe limitations in several of the plans, to check the draft plans, which is something that we didn't have in the past, and to have that mechanism also for making sure that then the ambition is put at the right level.
Thank you very much indeed. And where there are inconsistencies between the national policies and the EU policies, how are you dealing with that? As a UK citizen in Brussels, I feel a bit dangerously asking that question. But how do you overcome those sorts of challenges?
Well, now that we have the new framework in place, of course, the big challenge is transposition and implementation, and we need to put a lot of effort to make sure that we support member states as is needed to make sure that they put this regulatory framework in place and that it's implemented on the ground. But I think that we also need to have quite some incentives and to have, in parallel to the legislation, a very solid financial enabling framework to support also innovative financing tools so that they see that it's possible and that those can be also put in place in parallel to the legislation, and to keep working on what we have under our initiative for smart finance for smart buildings, which includes elements that were mentioned quite a lot as well, such as technical assistance for project aggregation, one-stop shops, so to work on the incentive side as well. And one of the things that we also want to do in the new multi-annual financial framework is to again create a kind of carrot and a stick incentive for member states by linking cohesion funding again to the revised regulatory framework, to the reinforced long-term renovation strategies, so that there is also an incentive for putting all this regulation in place in parallel to all the mechanisms that we have for working together with member states in the concerted action, for us to go to the member states in the sustainable energy investment forums, and for, of course, being available for meeting on a bilateral basis and supporting member states.
Paula Agathia, for now, thank you very much indeed. Agnieszka, can I come to you now? You've been working with the EBRD. You've very recently delivered, together with us, a covered green bond. How is that working? How challenging was that, putting that together?
So maybe a few words about PKO Mortgage Bank, if I may.
Please.
PKO is a part of PKO Banking Group, which is the biggest banking group in Poland and the leader in terms of mortgage lending to individual clients. And we are committed to the same CSR strategy as our mother company, and important for us is to reflect and react the needs of the society and the natural environment. PKO Bank Hipoteczny started its strategic project for financing the green building, green efficiency mortgage, with issuing covered bond almost a year ago. And we, as the first bank in Poland, began to preparation for this issue to finance residential green mortgages that would be available to the vast majority of Poles. This is, of course, a very challenging and very difficult way, and we have the assistance and the guidance of EBRD at the very beginning stage. So the EBRD, our green covered bond framework, was developed under the EBRD supervision and also guidance, what we really appreciate. We also intensively work and discuss with EBRD our methodology of assessing the green covered bond, the green mortgage loans that fulfill the mortgage eligibility criteria. And of course, it was a hard work. It took at least 1 year, but at the end we were able to introduce our first green covered bond issue 2 weeks ago.
We have a mantra at the EBRD that the green business is good business and you can make lots of money by being green. It obviously isn't that simple, but how do you roll out your green investments and how do you make them profitable?
According to low carbon building criteria for Polish residential property market, which is developed under the Climate Bond Initiative Green Building Standards, PKO is already financing its green loans that we have on our portfolio. But on the other hand, we also would like to we're working together with our parent company to introduce the dedicated product to finance the mortgage loans to individual customers. As a result of it, we also joined the Energy Efficient Mortgage Initiative in April, because we would like to be at the forefront of what it's been doing within the Europe as far as the mortgages standards. And we would like to follow this standard and introduce them also to our local market, which from the green perspective, it's not so deep, and it require a lot of work, of course. But what we would like to achieve is also let our client to reduce the CO2 emission and to improve, in fact, their ability to service the loan, because that's very important for us. We do not want to grant the mortgage green mortgage loans only for reducing the funding costs, but also, and this is the most important thing, to help our customers to improve the ability of servicing the loan and to reduce the CO2 emission.
And are you getting what you need from the regulators, from the policy makers, either from here or in Warsaw? And how do you work with them to make sure you do get what you need?
So from my perspective, higher energy efficiency has positive impact on the environment and also markets' financial stability. It leads to a reduction in the impact of energy cost to income, reducing borrowers' probability of default, and impacts positively of the property of valuation. So therefore, we look very much forward to preferential treatment for energy efficient mortgages in terms of lower capital requirements and lower risk weights. It will be very helpful for financial institutions that grant the loan. Another issue
which is that understood? Is that understood by the people you want it from, or are you still?
I know that from the Energy Efficient Mortgage Initiative, there is a discussion within the European Commission about this, but I also know that it's not a thing that will happen just like that, but it will take some time. But definitely it's something that would help the market to develop. Another thing, from my opinion, is the EPC's availability. I know that there is a challenge, not only in Poland, but also in other European countries, to get to these EPCs easily. And what will definitely help us, it would be the database that would be publicly available, at least to those institutions who grant the energy efficient mortgages. And to talk a little bit about the customer point of view also, I think that also from their perspective, for those who are applying for a mortgages to improve or to build the energy efficiency building, it will help to have some kind of tax reliefs.
Okay. I'm very keen to have some questions from the floor. I would like to ask James whether the cats have been herded to a certain extent. Do you think you get a sense that people are aligned, or are there challenges to that?
Not enough yet, and you give me the perfect chance to plug this report that we've just released, because I think, you know, it's great to hear so much talk of energy efficient mortgages. We think, you know, because of the transformative role that economic instrument plays in our economy, actually, and they get into people's heads at the time they're making property decisions, it's the perfect place to put energy efficiency. But we've set out guidance here for the property and the construction sector. How do you help banks in helping grow this, this market? Yeah. I think that we've seen this happen at the European level in this project, but we're now setting up national green mortgage hubs, Poland, Croatia, Italy, the UK, Spain, a number of other places, to bring those communities, banking, valuation, energy efficiency, construction, together to actually work on this market and these instruments longer term. So it's still work to be done, but the blueprint's there, and we're starting to see this happen in a number of markets.
Thank you, James. We've got 15 minutes until the Vice President of the Commission turns up to deliver his final speech of the week, but I would like to take your questions, and I understand that if you open something to the left of your chair, you can press a button and we can hear you. But you... Sorry, right at the back there, please, and could you say who you are and also who you'd like to direct the question to, please?
Yes, thank you. My name is Oliver Rapf. I'm the director of BPIE, Buildings Performance Institute Europe, here in Brussels. I have a question to the, well, to the private sector, both the banking sector and the real estate sector. To what degree is it a problem for you that most of the investment opportunities in buildings are rather small scale in terms of financial volume when you compare them to any other potential investments in green energy or climate change solutions? Is that an issue or is that not an issue? Do you see any emerging solutions entering the market? What's your take on that? Thank you.
Agnes, you don't care about first scaling up the market or maybe not being able to scale up the market, and then what do you do about that?
I, as a representative of a mortgage bank that are aimed to grant the mortgage loans, for me, it's not a problem. I mean, our day-to-day operations consist of that small investments because of the kind of activities we have. So,
Dimitris, from the delivery point of view, is it all too small to make a difference?
Well, I don't think that size matters in this situation. I mean, as long as the project that can be delivered is economically viable and sustainable, it should be easy to be financed and it should be welcomed. So I don't think that this is a problem. And on the other hand, in global world, we are creating also packages. I mean, we are merging our SPVs, and in order to create a bigger portfolio, so that it could be, can be more attractive to investors.
Thank you. More questions from the floor. Yes, please, in the middle.
Thank you, Adrian Joyce, director of the Renovate Europe campaign. I wanted to come back to what James said earlier about the need now to create demand and actually ask a question generally across the panel. I wondered to what extent you take the multiple benefits that arise from deep energy renovation into account in your thinking, in the offer that the bank makes, in the attraction that the developer makes for attracting new customers. So, two questions. To what extent do you take them into account? And secondly, what metrics do you use to talk about them?
So, well, the issue with the energy efficient buildings and the renewable energy solutions is that they cannot be valued in short term. So we need to educate our clients that renting in a, or acquiring a space in a, an energy efficient building, they need to they will have sustainability, and they will need they will mean to stay in the space, okay, for a longer period. Which means that they will not have to move after 5 years. They will seek long-term leases. And this needs education, especially in emerging markets like we are in Romania, where
The average leases are less than 6 years or not even 5 years. So this is the first thing that we need to educate. The other thing is that we need to make the client understand that the benefits of an energy efficient building or a zero CO building, and these benefits are directly to the end user, which is the which are the employees of the tenant. That's why, apart from the efficiency, the energy efficiency in the buildings, we want to create a community. And by creating a community, you attract people, you attract employees, and then the building, the office building, becomes a community, an environment that is pleasant for the people. So they make you make them come to work with pleasure. Okay. So apart from advertising the efficiency, you need to advertise also the environment, the community that you create within a business environment.
Thank you, Aniska.
From the Mortgage Bank perspective, we, taking into account the energy efficiency by assessing the energy performance certificate, and not only for new buildings, but also for renovation, but there should be at least 30% improvement if energy efficiency, as if we are talking about the renovation. And what we would like, as I mentioned before, to give our customers the awareness that we are really helping them to reduce the CO2 emission and to improve their ability to service their loans.
James, you want to come in? Or?
Yeah, can I come in briefly? I mean, for commercial property owner-occupiers, yeah, and some of our members are doing wonderful stuff on productivity mapping to actually show, particularly to CFOs, decision-makers, actually what a difference a building that performs properly for your staff can make. Certainly for kind of residential, the residential sector, it adds to the value proposition, but we've found it's a great lever, for example, in working with city colleagues whose primary concern in some of the kind of things they're investing in their cities is not necessarily just the energy efficiency of buildings, but the health and well-being of their citizens. So it's definitely a driver at that wider level, and actually cracking on and getting data on how the programmes we're driving on energy efficiency is really making those impacts felt on health and well-being at the city scale is an important challenge to get cities to really start to focus minds on these kind of programmes.
Wow.
Yes, yeah, so also from the Commission side, we think it's really a critical point, and we use quite a lot the information available on the quantification of the wider benefits of energy efficiency for arguing for more ambitious requirements. We also have in the long-term renovation strategies a requirement for Member States to look into that and to try to quantify the expected benefits of the renovation programme, so this gradually should also create more awareness. And then also to mention quickly that also through our work with the Energy Efficiency Financial Institutions Group, we want to look more into this aspect to try to quantify these multiple benefits and to see how we can feed that information to financial institutions so that it also stimulates more financing into energy efficiency.
Thank you. Any further questions from the floor?
Can I come?
Sorry, absolutely.
Can I just bring in a bit of disagreement with the panel here at the last moment? But no, because I think that the question Oliver raised about, you know, actually kind of aggregation and scale, is it a problem? And you ask people for whom perhaps if you've got the right project that you're lending a mortgage to or one of the projects that you're involved in, that's less the issue. But what we've certainly found that in terms of when you're engaging in the capital with the players in the capital markets, so where are we raising money for your mortgages? Actually, where are we going to make pricing differentials? That scale question is really important. Are there market standards so that energy efficiency renovation programs are a bit more standardized so they can properly tag these, so we can kind of make sense of these in the capital market? So I know I think we would have got a different answer to that question from certain other players. It is an important consideration, I think.
Okay, thank you very much. Question there, please.
Hello. I would like to pose a question to Agnieszka Zinieczka, Director Head of Treasury. Have you already got a relief on Ponder on Tier 1 when buying, when placing loans to residential mortgage to buildings, green build, to loans for green buildings? Or is this only desire? The second question would be, would it be helpful if Central Bank, or you are not in Euro, but European Central Bank, preferred buying RMBS that is basically green, that has green loans as underlying? And also, would it be helpful to you, for example, if in a taxonomy or in another framework, there would be like a credit certificate, a tax certificate by which individual person who renovated home or houses would pay back the bills, because this is directly, so to say, cash flow, and this has been successful in California. And also to the European Commission, I would ask one question to Paula Rey Garcia, if possible. Would you consider within DG FISMA to, within Solvency II, introducing a possibility whereby this kind of RMBS, green RMBS, could be bought by insurance company? Thank you.
Thank you, Agnieszka, first with two questions.
Thank you very much. So, taking into account your first question, there is no preferential treatment as far as green mortgages in relation to conventional mortgages, and that was my my question and my my proposal for some intensive that mortgage banks would have when they are granting mortgage loans, to have this preferential treatment as far as weights and capital reliefs. But actually there is no such such treatments. As far as RBS, in fact, to the mortgage banks, this is not an issue. The European Central Bank, what's important from the investor perspective that we have as a as an issuer on the international market, what's very important for the investor, that our covered bond are eligible for repo operation within within European Bank. So that's the that's important for us. And the third question, I...
The third question was with if credit certificates help. This is a tax, these are tax credits like used in California, whereby a borrower could repay by a tax credit from his tax check instead of...
I think that it can be a topic for further discussion, and also here in Europe we have the same situation in Denmark. In fact, there also is the possibility that the maybe not tax certificate, but the bondholders, which is the retail customer, can in fact repay his mortgage using this covered bond.
Thank you very much indeed. We are now coming to the end of our session. We have to play musical chairs again as the Vice President of the Commission comes in. I'd like to thank you all for being here. Oh, I do beg your pardon. I do beg your pardon. Sorry.
If there is no time, but otherwise I would be happy to.
There was something going like that out the window. And I just... Please, I beg your pardon.
Sorry, sorry to come in. No, so indeed this is a very important question that you raise. Although I'm not in DG FISMA, it's clear that now with the work that DG FISMA is leading on sustainable finance, and also with the flagship initiative, Energy Efficiency Mortgage Initiative, there is a lot of awareness on the issues that you are mentioning. So I think it's really a route that is getting closer and closer, and that from the energy side, what we are doing is, again, through the Energy Efficiency Financial Institution Group, building the evidence that should help then such a revision, if it happens in the future, then properly take into account these aspects for capital requirements.
On that note, I'd like to thank you, Palerim, Garcia, Dimitris Pagamalis, Agnieszka, and James, and the Commission for co-hosting this, and thank you very much for coming. Thank you.
dear all, I would like to welcome the Vice President Maros Sefcovic, Vice President of the European Commission in charge of Energy Union. Thank you, Maros. Jerzy Buzek, President of ITRE Committee, just re-elected for a new mandate. We are very pleased, the second best elected in Poland. And as you know, he has been also former Prime Minister of Poland, former President of the European Parliament. Accordingly, we can count on him for playing again a decisive role in support of energy policy. And Julien Guerrier, the Director of EASM, the executive agency in charge of many concrete projects dedicated to energy, very important, clean energy transition. For this concluding session of the 14th edition of EU Sustainable Energy Week, the most important ever organized in terms of participation, in terms of quality of event, arriving just after the publication of the last legislation, the fourth legislation of market design has been published in June 14. This will represent the most advanced regulatory framework in support of clean energy transition in the world. As you know, the lack of regulatory framework is the first obstacle for investment. But now, the challenge will be to implement that, to translate all the provision of legislation into concrete projects, to go also into the direction of access to finance, more easy access to finance, to sustainable finance. We will manage that in the context of a new EU Invest. And of course, it will be also important to facilitate the development of new technologies. The Vice President has pushed a lot for batteries, the European Alliance for Batteries, so important. But we will have the same challenge for all aspects of storage, for hydrogen, for CCS and CCU. But let me say, energy has contributed to unite Europe, not to divide Europe. We have put in place a fantastic new and unique example of cooperation in Europe. And the last and most recent example has been the national plan, for energy and climate. And this week, the European Commission, the College of Commissioners, has presented some recommendations for the finalization of the plan by the end of this year. But again, in a spirit of cooperation, taking into account all main characteristics existing in the different member states. This is a culture of cooperation at the basis of our success. It was a key for having a massive support from member states for our legislation and a massive support from you for all stakeholders. This is the way to proceed. And let me say, I would like also to pay tribute to EBRD and EIB for going into the same direction, in the direction of sustainable finance, in the direction of financing renewables in particular, but also interconnection, but also energy efficiency. And your two presidents are really key allies regarding this challenge. And thank you for that. And I would like now to invite Julien to present to you a summary of the main event organized during these 3 days. And after that, I will pass the floor to the Vice President and to President Buzek. Please, Julien, you have the floor.
Thank you very much. Good evening, Mr. Vice President, Mr. Director General, Mr. President. Good evening to all of you, ladies and gentlemen. It is actually the 14th time that we are organizing this EU Sustainable Energy Week. Our agency, EASME, is 15 years old, so it's been a constant feature over the whole life of our agency. And it all started as an awareness-raising campaign at a time, many years ago, when electric light bulbs and the energy efficient light bulbs were just starting to emerge and where sustainable and energy efficiency were concepts that were still at their very, very early stages. So we have gone a very long way in these many years. Today, sustainable energy is well recognized. It is a main topic of the debate in Europe. We saw it in the electoral debate. We see it on the streets in Europe. We see it this week with almost 4,000 participants registered to this Sustainable Energy Week. So there are more participants than ever, and I think the big success and the attractiveness of this Sustainable Energy Week is because we invite all relevant stakeholders. All of you, many more. We've had more than 90 workshops, more than 150 organizations participating. They all share an interest in sustainable energy, but from very different angles and fields. So I hope that you had the opportunity to join many of those workshops, that you went to the energy fair, to the energy talks, that you saw the lab that was showcasing a lot of the concrete projects you were talking about. It was an opportunity to exchange within the community, to exchange physically and not, as we very often do nowadays, digitally. It makes a difference in establishing contacts. And one of the features also of this week is that it was not limited to the Brussels bubble. We were not only here with all those workshops, but we organized throughout Europe more than 300 events, the so-called local energy days. They took place, making it a really, truly European event. And everywhere, we try to showcase, as we did here at the lab, concrete projects that make it tangible and that show how we can support and implement those policies. We had also the EU Sustainable Energy Award, so congratulations to all the winners, if there are some in the audience. Now, if you ask me about the main takeaways that I keep from this week, I would mention that we see clear progress on some of the key topics, such as buildings, transport, renewable energy, and consumers. But we see also some emerging topics, some new trends that take more and more importance, in particular digitalization and, as you mentioned, sustainable finance. On the progress that we see on our traditional topics, we had a lot of focus in the workshops on the key role of sound renovation strategies, the need to scale up deep renovation in order to meet our EU targets for 2030. On the role also of low carbon fuels, on hydrogen, of innovative mobility solutions, on how citizens' cooperatives have been extremely effective in involving citizens in the energy transition, on the promotion of successful ways to involve consumers and to eradicate, and this is a theme that is gaining political importance, eradicating energy poverty across Europe. As regards the topics gaining more attention, digitalization will play a leading role in decarbonizing the energy system. The need for attracting more private investment in financing the energy transition is more acute than ever. But also we could see throughout the sessions an importance given to the theme of decarbonizing Europe by 2050. This has really gained momentum, and we need to discuss how our future energy systems will now deal with increasing shares of renewables, electrification, storage, such as what we are doing for the strategic approach on batteries. So to conclude, a word on how we at the agency are trying to support these priorities in the field of sustainable energy. You could see all those concrete projects across the 3 days and across our exhibitions in Europe. They are supported mainly by the Horizon 2020 Programme for Research and Innovation and by LIFE for Climate and Environment. They effectively trigger changes on the ground. Let me just mention one example that I like particularly. Octave in Alsace is setting up a one-stop shop offering homeowners a very effective and simple service that avoids them having to go to the architect, to the public authorities to get the subsidies, to the companies to conduct the works. There is a one-stop shop service subsidized by us and by the region that offers that. It is increasing the renovation rate in the region, and we hope it will increase that by 1,500 per year in the coming couple of years. So these projects are also an opportunity for us to be plugged in with the ground and to get back to DG Energy with the experience that we gain there in order to feed policy development. That's also an important way of concretely supporting the Commission's policy priorities. And talking about DG Energy, I cannot close, Dominique, without expressing my special thanks to you, because 15 years ago, it was you who created the agency. We were called at the time the Intelligent Energy Agency, and you've seen everything that we were able to do in the past 15 years. And it's not only an agency for energy and for intelligent energy in Europe that was created, but it's a new model. And it was so successful that after that, five other executive agencies were created by the Commission, and now basically most of the European budget managed under direct management, so directly by the Commission, is delegated to those six agencies. So that's not a small achievement. Thanks very much, and thanks to all of you for this week.
Thank you, Julien, and I'm so happy to see this impressive evolution of your agency. And thank you to you and your team for co-organizing so well all these events with my team, with DGNR, with AESE. Thank you very much. And now I have the pleasure and the privilege to pass the floor to the Vice President of the Commission in charge of Energy Union. We are together with President Juncker and some EU leaders for finalizing a new decisive step for synchronization for the Baltic states. But now he will also conclude on behalf of the European Commission. Maros, please, you have the floor.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dominique. Thank you very much, Julien, for that presentation. And of course, a big thank you goes to Jerzy Buzek, not only for sharing with us the place on the podium in the panel, but for, I would say, unprecedentedly close and efficient relationship we had between the Commission and the European Parliament. And I think we have to say it now very loudly, thanks to you, we really managed to complete all the action plan and really work on all the legislative proposals, which is part of the Energy Union strategy, which we prepared together. And I'm very glad that thanks to your stamina in endless trilogues, which you shared with Dominique and my colleague, Commissioner Cañete, you really help us to make sure that Energy Union is now very solidly on the ground. Everything what we promised is done, and now, of course, we have to focus on the implementation. When I was listening to the figures presented by Julien, I thought that the main event of this week is actually the European Council. But I was mistaken, as I see. Yeah? So everybody's looking at the building, which is just next to us. But the fact that you've managed to have such a high participation of 4,000 people and really dozens and dozens of events here in Brussels, but across the European Union, that's really a big achievement. And it just shows that the topic which you put on the agenda, the issues we are dealing with are extremely important, not only for the stakeholders, not only for the professionals, but as we have seen in the European elections, also for the wider public. And when my 19-year-old son showed me very proudly his super fashionable trousers, and he tells me that this is from reused fabric, Daddy, and you should learn from us how, you know, we are reusing the material. That's something that you see that our messages go through, and that circular economy, sustainable approach to how we live our lives is really taking ground. And I'm sure that our young generation will really get it where we would like to see it. And I believe that our leaders will confirm it this evening or tomorrow morning, that we will have climate neutral Europe by 2050. I would like to just react to a couple of remarks which have been made throughout the week and in the previous presentation. and also to use the opportunity that we have our EBRD representative with us. I'm always saying that sometimes I like that competition which is there between EBRD and EIB, who has the better products for our mayors, who can make it more user-friendly for them to invest in energy efficiency, in circular economy, and in development of sustainable plans. Each progressive mayor today is actually putting on the agenda. And I'm therefore very glad that the discussion we just concluded before we arrived was on energy efficiency, because I remember very vividly, like we had, I think, also in this room, very live debate about how we are going to implement energy efficiency first principle, what we can put on the ground, how we can make sure that the mayors, the financial institutions would take it up, and what can we do from the side of the European budget. But I think that the fact that these projects are so popular, that the mayors are interested, that the challenge which is there is more and more perceived as an opportunity, is the proof that I believe we are doing the right thing and going into the right direction. Because we still have to remind ourselves that despite the fact that we are the first major economy which puts all our commitments we've undertaken when signing up to the Paris Agreement, we transformed and transposed into the law, and now we are gradually implementing, that still the challenge there is enormous. And energy efficiency can be one of the principal answers how we're going to meet them. Because still, 40% of our energy we are consuming in our buildings. So let's imagine if we would be able to use the current technology we know, smart metering, better isolation, all the new materials which are already developed in Europe, put it in place and just reduce the consumption of energy in our buildings by 10-15%, what kind of achievement that would be. And on top of it, what is also for me very important is that you are improving the quality of the life of the people living in these buildings. I went to see a project on energy efficiency in Paris, and I visited several buildings. I was talking to the tenants, the people living. It was a social housing project. And I was asking, okay, so, you know, how did you like it? What was your attitude when, you know, the owner of the building came and told you that we are going to do this refurbishment and actually that it will be an EU project? So I told him, of course, we'd be not very happy because we didn't believe that you can complete the renovation within such a short period of time. Of course, we've been worried that all these workers would be here and what will it do to the building, but now we like it because we have a feeling like we are living in a new building. Our invoice for energy is down by 1,000 euro per year, and we breathe a cleaner air, and we feel that our quality of life has significantly improved because we are living in a healthy environment. And that was something where I said that, you know, from the point of view of how to talk to the people in Europe, how to be more concrete with what Europe can do for them, this was very important because we improved the environment, we improved the quality of life, and we did something good also for the citizens in a concrete city who would, I'm sure, remember it forever because they are living in these apartments. So what I want to say is that energy efficiency, smart buildings would be really part of the response, but that response would need a lot of money, because our estimate is that just to meet our 2030 targets and to get to that level of energy efficiency, which European Parliament with our member states decided to achieve 32.5%, we would need like 130 to 200 billion euros per year going only for the buildings. So we need to put also together the innovative financing, financial instruments, which would really make it possible to get to that level. And I'm sure that not only the environment, but especially the people in the cities would be the first to benefit from them. I think we have also, after 14 years of the great work of agency, take some lessons from the past. I mean, one of the lessons which we should not repeat is PV panels, because we invented them here in Europe. we deployed them first. We've been kind of showcasing them as a new technology to the whole world. Now we are almost solely importing them. The good thing is that we are still very strong and I believe best in the world if it comes to system integration, if it comes to the smart system which are running the operation of the PVs. But the fact that we be not able to keep the production of such a strategic commodity like PV panels, that's a not good omen for the future. Therefore, we are doing so much in making sure that we would not be technologically dependent if it comes to the batteries, if it comes to energy storage. Who else should be leader in storing the energy than the economy, which is producing the most or biggest proportion of its energy from renewables, from PVs, from windmills, from biomass, and from very often intermittent sources which require the ability to store energy and use it in a peak time. So if we want to be the climate leaders, we have to be also technological leaders. We have to be the best in system integration, in smart grids. We have to be the best in battery development, in sustainability, in making sure that all the products we produce in this way would have zero carbon footprint and would be reused or recycled. This is what should be the new European economy, and I think to that we would have to adjust our industrial policies in Europe. If you allow me just to make one more point, which I think is very important for Jerzy, for myself, and also for our discussions here. Very often we've been approaching the climate change and the energy transition from the point of view of technocracy. I think this is what we need to do. This is what is the role of the Commission. This is what is the role of executive agency. But I think we would need to do much more in the future in also adding additional elements to our effort. The first would be the social, and second one would be the point of communication, what we are doing, why is it important, and why people should support it and go with us in that direction. And therefore, when we've been discussing this big package, clean energy for all legislation, I said there is no way how we can omit one important particular element in the legislation, and these are the social aspects of the transition. This is the worry of a coal miner in some regions, that they would be left behind and nobody would be able to help them with the future economic development. That was the question of the energy poverty, which is still really very much on mind of 50 million Europeans who have every month's problem to pay for the bills. And we have to demonstrate that by what we are doing, we are actually investing into the future to have energy which would be smarter, which would be more affordable, and where we would be able to take care of those who need it the most, or the people in transition regions, or the people who might face some kind of temporary problems and be in the situation where they have to think, do I have to pay my electricity bill or buy the bread from for my children? I think this is why Europe is successful. This is why Europe is so attractive for everybody else, because they see that we are doing our utmost to be fair, to be responsible, and to be predictable. And to use these adjectives, I can definitely use them again if I would like to describe the outcome, the conclusions, and lots of new ideas which have been presented to all of us during this week of very intense discussions. And I really would like to thank you all, not only for coming to Brussels, but being very active participants here and in other events across the Europe, but especially for your commitment, which you are showing in your daily lives to the challenge, which is probably the one we have to face as a mankind to tackle the climate change and to do it in fair, socially just way. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Vice President, and you are right. What we have done should be profitable not only for our economies, but at the end of the day for all European peoples. And in that context, I would like now to pass the floor to President Buzek. As it was said, he has been present in all fronts of energy, present in all meetings, sometimes rapporteur for some key aspects of energy security. But at the end, his presence, his support have been decisive in order to finalize properly all the things. So thank you very much, and you have the floor, please.
Good afternoon. Well, I never could imagine that such a crowded hall in closing session is first time probably in my life. Thank you very much for your presence. You see, usually 20, 30 people which could not well catch another train or something like that. And you are probably listening for something special. Maybe I can give you something special, but let me say at the beginning, Mr. Director Julien Garrier said almost everything, and additions from Mr. Vice President, from my point of view, really very important, thinking about citizens. Well, I delivered two speeches in the time of this Energy Week, so I think it's enough. I would like to say too much, and we should be finished at well, in 2 minutes. Okay. Maybe Mr. Director General would like to say something additional. So please, you are absolutely responsible for this session. So let me say, great summary, dear friends, Mr. Vice President, Director. It's very difficult to add anything. Well, we would like to make our European Union suitable also for people from 40 regions, more or less 40 regions, core regions, and they are in difficult situation, losing jobs, thinking about the future. Please remember about that. Just transition fund as additional money in our budget, additional money, fresh money, and subheading in our European budget for next 7 years is absolutely necessary to give such a signal to 50 million of citizens of such regions in our Europe, from Spain to Poland, from Romania to Germany, a lot of them. And of course, digitalization, very issues, almost everything was empowering consumers and turning them into energy producers. It was a very important topic. Even gender equality, everything has been said in the time of this meeting. So thank you very, very much. Well, we will probably charge our batteries. We have to charge our batteries to innovate and advance in our energy transition. So we are ready for next year, for 15th meeting. But I will say only two things at the very, very end. I could not imagine the next term in the European Commission or any next term. Next, the closest term, and in 5 years, in 10 years, as fruitful term in European Commission and maybe in European Parliament as the last one. You must remember, Energy Union, as a matter of fact, we started the whole idea 5 years ago, and we almost have finished everything what is necessary to close the Energy Union. Quite a new idea 5 years ago. I think, Mr. Vice President, or everything in European Commission is in front of you, of course. But let me say, it is your legacy, because it was said at the beginning of your term in office. So thank you very, very much for everything what has been done. Of course, together with Mr. Commissioner Cagnetti, both of you have done a lot of work in this issue. That is one point from myself. not saying too much for the end of our meeting. Third speech is impossible to deliver for you without repeating everything what you said before. And, well, let me say, somebody was the main organizers of the meeting and the whole energy transition week and all the meetings take care about all of us. Dominique Ristori, Mr. Director General, let me say, we will finish in 10 days Dominique Ristori era in our energy sector. I am quite sure that your influence on everything what has been done in last years was enormous in many, many points. I believe that even if you are physically going back to Corsica, I don't know your future at all, but physically, please, mentally and spiritually be with us. We count on you. And if you go around your tremendous island or tremendous country, France, around Europe or around planet, please help us in everything what we are ready to do in the future. Be active as it was in last years, and all the best to your new activity. I'm quite sure that you've got quite a new field, and we wish you all the best. Mr. Vice President, Director, and Director General, all the best. Thank you, dear colleagues. One year.
Thank you very much, President Buzek, for your very kind words, and you can count on my permanent support, all of you, for energy policy and the support to clean energy transition. In any case, we have put in place a lot of things, but implementation will be key for the following years, and implementation will require the contribution and the mobilization of all. Accordingly, as you said both, working together will be key at all levels, and the ball is also in your camp, because in the new context, each citizen, each person will and should contribute to the clean energy transition and for a better life for everybody, for more solidarity and social equity. Thank you very much, and all the best for the future. Thank you very much.